The following is an exclusive presentation of HDNet. Matt Hughes has proven he's the best of the best, time and time again. A two-time welterweight champion, Hughes is one of the most decorated fighters in UFC history and the most winningest. Staging a record 7 title defenses, many wondered if Hughes could be beaten. The answer came on November 18th, 2006. Hughes' 6-fight win streak halted by George St. Pierre. After losing the belt to St. Pierre, Hughes dropped 2 of his next 3 fights and began to contemplate retirement. But after beating longtime nemesis Matt Serra in May 2009, the 36-year-old Hughes is reinvigorated and hoping to reclaim his spot atop the UFC. From HDNet, this is Fighting Words with Mike Straka. This week's guest, Matt Hughes.
There are many legends in the sport of MMA. Matt Hughes, you're one of those legends. People thought that you were done fighting, particularly after the last GSP fight. You know, you told me after that fight, you never had George in a dominant position. What am I going to do next? Then you fought Matt Serra, beat up Matt Serra. What's going on in your career? How much further can you go?
Boy, I don't know. I'm really taking it one fight at a time. But the one thing about it is I love competing. I still love being in there. Still love the training. So why not? You know, and it's one of those things. I'll take it one fight at a time, and if I ever feel like I don't want to be in there, I don't want to compete, then that's when I'll walk away.
Do you always feel like you're at the highest level of competition? I mean, obviously you are, but how do you internalize that?
It's an interesting question. You know, I don't think about that. Now that you've asked and I look back, yeah, I've always fought the toughest guys. Matt Serra, previous world champion, GSP, Thiago Alves was the number one guy for a little while. So, I mean, it does seem like that. But to me, it's just another day. It's another opponent. I just got to go in the octagon and the way I say is provide for my family.
You know, it's funny. I'm talking as if you're done with your career. Do you feel like you've accomplished everything you set out to do?
Yeah, I guess, because I've never been that guy to chase records. I really haven't. I'm a 9-time world champion, but you know what? It's just a matter of time before somebody comes and takes that away from me. You know, I realize that. So I just don't chase records. You know, I go out and do what I do, and I happen to be good at it. I happen to enjoy it, and I'll continue to do that.
Do you think that guys, when they get older, like Randy Couture, for instance, do you think he has an advantage being older?
Boy, I don't know about that. I think whoever's older has a disadvantage. You know, it takes me longer to prepare. It takes me longer to get through my injuries. Takes the bruises longer to get away. So I would say being older is a disadvantage. The only positive would be the experience. You know, I've been in a lot of situations. I don't get rattled out there as easy as I used to. So, I'd much rather be that 28-year-old kid out there full of gumption that doesn't know how to lose. Very athletic than an older gentleman like me who picks his battles, picks his situations, and goes with it. I'd love to see the 28-year-old Matt Hughes fight the GSP today. I think it'd be very interesting. Back then, I didn't know I could really lose that many ways. I was going out there, I was just athletic, yep, having a good time with it, and making people do what I wanted to do. And now I just kind of relax. I'm comfortable on my back anymore. It doesn't bother me that much when I get taken down. So it's a lot changes when you the more you learn about the sport.
Mm-hmm. Do you feel like, you know, elaborating on what you just said, going back and wish you could be 28 years old fighting the GSP of today, do you feel like you've learned things that you were resistant to when you were 28? For instance, Brazilian Jiu-Jitsu or a stand-up game. Were you relying too much on your wrestling skills?
I think I relied a lot on my wrestling skills. I think that won a lot of matches for me. I think that still wins matches for me. That's what I credit the Hoyce Gracie win to, was my American wrestling. I was just able to control him. He wasn't used to that. But I don't think that was a bad thing either. I really don't. I was so young and so athletic, I did whatever I wanted to do. People didn't have the strength to keep up with me or the athleticism back then. So it was a fun game. Go in, beat somebody up, and walk away, and have a good time with my teammates the whole time.
In your book, Made in America, you talked a lot about you and your brother, your twin brother, growing up and always wrestling and beating each other up in a backyard and hitting each other with baseball bats and things like of that nature. Not so bad, but you might as well have been.
Yes.
How growing up in that atmosphere, did it create the fighter that you are today? And why is your brother not a professional MMA fighter?
Well, I'll answer the first question first. I think what really made me who I am today is the fact that I had a twin brother, and that brought competition in my life very, very early. Mm-hmm. The second thing is growing up on a farm, and with the farm work, I was always had something to do. So I learned competition and work ethic early on, and it stayed with me. So I think that's what's made me successful are those two things. My brother was the type of guy that when he wrestled, he was always, he's gonna go through his opponent. He was gonna out-muscle him. And when it came to somebody who had his strength and had more technique, he'd lose. So Mark got to the point where he was going to have to really start training to compete in the sport, and he just elected not to.
Are you sorry for him that he didn't do it?
It's up to him. You know, he's got a family now and works. So, you know, everybody picks their own road, and he's where he's at because that's, you know, his choices.
How does your wife handle your professional fighting career? I mean, obviously she handles it.
Well, I've known my wife forever, so she's known me for a long time. She's, you know, I was wrestling in high school and college when I first started to know her, and she knows that's who I am, so she's all right with it. But she gets nervous. She does. When I fought Trigg the first time, we were in an arena like this, and Trigg got on top of me and started throwing some punches, and she ran from the bottom all the way up to the top. When she got to the top, she turned around and saw that I was on top of Trigg and turned around and ran all the way back down to the bottom then. So it's a roller coaster for her, you know, ups and downs, ups and downs. I'm on top of somebody, I'm beneath somebody, so it's an emotional roller coaster for her.
Does she understand that sometimes it looks a lot worse than it is?
She does. She does.
But how does she know?
She doesn't, right. You know. It's got to be hard for her. And I can relate to that because when I've got a good friend like Robbie Lawler or my brother fighting in the octagon and I'm on the outside of the fence coaching, it's hard on me. I would much rather be in the octagon fighting than outside the octagon where I can't do anything. So I've always said it's harder on the cornerman than it is the fighter, because you're yelling, you don't know if your fighter's hearing you, you're trying to say the right things, and you can't do anything. I'm outside, he's on the inside, and it's not who I am. When my buddies are going through a hard time, I'm right next to him most of the time. With the cage, I can't do that.
When you were coming up in the sport, you'd take a fight essentially for the money. I mean, is that fair to say?
Some of my best times I've ever had when it was early in the sport. I was going around, I was fighting with Jeremy Horn, Jens Pulver, my brother, Pat Miletich sometimes. He was always cornering us. And that, it was just a lot of fun. It's what we did. We all somewhat lived in the same area. We trained together and we went and fought together. And those are the fun times. Those are the fun times. And of course, drawing a paycheck as well.
Right. But when did it become a job?
After I won the belt, it was really a job, no doubt about it. People started to know who I was, signing autographs. That's kind of my, I didn't have my buddies fighting on the same card with me after I won the belt. You know, if I had one fighter with me, like a Jens Pulver or Jeremy Horn on the card, I really felt lucky because I had more cornermen there, I had more friends there. But after I won the belt, it was more of a job, no doubt about it. Actually, that's when before that fight, I made a decision that if I lost this fight against Carlos Newton, I was done. Walking out, gonna go find a 9-to-5er and do something with my hands. But I ended up winning the fight and it changed my life.
Do you think that the sport of MMA has created a whole new era or a whole new definition of fighters?
I definitely think so. You know, back when I started, you could be one-dimensional. You could just be a wrestler. And I was a wrestler that knew submissions that had very limited stand-up. But I could beat people because if somebody was close enough to punch me, I was close enough to take them down. And when they hit the ground, I was so strong and I knew how to stay out of bad situations, I could beat them. But now it's just not that way anymore. You got to be top at everything. You got to know striking, wrestling, and submissions. If you don't know them all, somebody's going to exploit it.
You know, a lot we always go back to when George said that he lost his first fight against you before he even stepped into the octagon because he was afraid of you, and he worshipped you. He looked up to you. Who do you look up to?
I still look up to Pat Miletic. Great guy. We don't talk as much anymore, but I tell you what, that guy was hard to spar with. He was hard to wrestle with, and he was hard to grapple with. He's just very well-rounded, and I think he doesn't get probably the credit he should in this sport. He's a pioneer, and he's still. I would put Pat against GSP because I'd love to see the matchup. I'd love to see what happens. You know, I'd love to see GSP strike with him. Number one, I look up to Pat. No doubt about it. He's probably the front runner there.
How good do you think GSP is now?
GSP's on top of the world. No doubt about it. He is. I mean, his wrestling's very good. What I think GSP does a really good job with is his transition. He can transition from striking to wrestling very quick and disguise it so people just don't see it. So that's one of his best wrestling qualities is his transitions.
You know, a lot of you fighters talk about fighting as if it's an art form and also scientific. You know, it's not like you guys talk about, all right, I'm going to go out there and do this move. You talk about transitions, being transparent, being elusive. What is it about your sport that gives you guys that eloquence in describing it?
I think us fighters know that it's a chess match out there. You know, to every move there's a counter, and every counter there's a counter. So I've got to watch and see what my opponent's doing. He could be setting something up two or three moves down the line, which a lot of guys do that. I mean, Jeremy Horn's great at that, setting you up so you move your hand and set him into a submission. We realize that. It's a chess match, and a lot of the public don't realize how much strategy there is out there.
More with Matt Hughes. Stand by.
Coming up next on Fighting Words with Mike Straka.
You've had a lot of success in this world of MMA and wrestling. What are your disappointments?
That's coming up next on Fighting Words with Mike Straka. Coming up, it's the hottest mixed martial arts show on TV. From MMA's biggest names to the most anticipated live events, see it all on Inside MMA, next on HDNet.
Girls Gone Wild is on the search for the hottest girl in America.
So what will it take to be the hottest girl in America?
There has to be a look. There has to be an innocence about them. There has to be an attitude. This competition is going to be decided by you and only you, America.
Hey, guys, Girls Gone Wild is coming to HDNet.
Seriously, if you're looking for some fun in the sun, then this is where it's at. This is where you want to be.
Good. I recommend this party.
I'm hot, and I kind of want to get in the water.
We're going to strip. Let's go do this.
Where in the world does Katie Darrell get all of that energy? Ah!
Hard man! I love your show in high def. I watched that. It reminds me back in the day.
I'm just thrilled to be here and excited to be on this trip.
Inhibitions run wild.
A 5 plus a 6, together they're an 11.
This is Nirvana.
It sounds like you're just getting started.
No, oh yeah.
Don't miss a minute of the madness.
So nice, you get it twice.
Guys Night In, right here, baby. I love her.
Best time of my life.
Guys Night In, on Thursday and Saturday.
Welcome back to Fighting Words with Mike Straka. This week's guest, Matt Hughes.
Welcome back, Matt. Elite athletes like yourself have to have a selfish mentality. You have to think about your diet all the time. You have to think about your rest. You have to think about your training. Does anybody ever say to you, all you ever do is think about yourself? It's always about you. It's always about you.
Probably just my wife, but she's half joking. When I was early in my career, it was easy because I lived by myself. I woke up, I trained, I went to sleep. I thought about training. I woke up, I trained, you know, and you throw some food in there somewhere, and that's all I did. Now I've got 4 kids, a wife, and it's just not as easy to get those good meals in, maybe that rest with a newborn kid, and getting away where I want to spend time with my family, getting away to go train. So it's a lot more complicated now than it used to be.
Boys and girls?
Boys and girls, 2 and 2.
What's it like, what's it going to be like being Matt Hughes' son?
Well, you know, I don't know. I've got my 2 oldest is a 10 and an 8 boy, and then a 3 and a half and a newborn girl. So it's going to be interesting. I know exactly what I'm going to do when my first girl brings a boy home. I'll be cleaning a gun that will be able to reach him from many, many yards away. And I'll probably let him take a shell home with him and say, hey, you know, treat my girl right, or you know, I don't have to put my hands on you to hurt you. But I've already got it planned out. That's what I'll be doing. I want this gentleman to know that, you know, even though he stays away from me, he's not out of the danger zone.
Do you have any regrets at all from the life that you chose to live?
Well, I think everybody's got regrets. You know, when it comes to fighting, I probably don't have that many. Sure, I could have trained harder for some people, could have done things different in the octagon, but for the most part, I'm pretty happy.
Do you ever get sick of watching yourself fight?
I don't watch myself fight. I just don't. Never really have. Used to, I would, when I was a title holder, I would watch the fights one time because I just liked to hear what the commentators had to say. That was it. I don't even know the last time I've watched one of my fights. It'd be years ago.
Do you feel like, as a fighter, there's nobody you wouldn't fight?
I think I would probably fight anybody in my weight class and maybe even one up. I've always wrestled and fought bigger guys, so I probably would, yeah.
Are you happy with your legacy at the UFC?
So, you know, I told you before, I don't really look at the records and this and that, so, you know, I do hold the most defenses right now, but like I said, that's going to change. Somebody's going to knock me off, you know. Silva's getting close. You know, GSP puts some more wins together. He'll be getting close. So I mean, it's going to get changed. Somebody's going to beat me. And legacy's a big word for me. And I just don't know if I would consider myself to have a legacy.
You look at guys like Rich Franklin, like you, people who've been around the sport in the UFC for a long time and never complain about the UFC. And then there's other people like Randy or like Tito who have had their differences with the UFC. Why is your experience different than theirs?
Well, I really don't know. Tito's Tito, you know, and I think he's made some bad decisions. And, you know, so that's probably why he doesn't get along with the UFC. Randy, I just don't know. But I can tell you that Dana White and I are extremely good friends. You know, I see Dana like a boss. He's like a friend, and he's also, I seem like a father. You know, if I need something, I can call Dana White, and he's probably going to help me out. You know, I think Dana White is extremely misunderstood by most people. When Dana White walks into an arena to go sit in his seat, it takes him probably about an hour because he never says no to an autograph. He is by far the best when it comes to signing autographs, taking pictures, being with the public.
Yep.
I've had guys say, hey, you know, we drove down from Canada, you know, just to come see the sport. He'll get a better ticket so that couple will have a better seat at the house.
I've seen that too.
And so, I mean, Dana's the best. He really is. When it comes to talking with the public and being friendly and doing what the public wants, Dana's the leader there.
Recently, UFC 100 was a historic event, obviously, and they released the 100 top fights in the UFC. Did you see that DVD?
I did see a little bit. I was over at my mother-in-law's, and they had it on the TV, so I did watch some of it.
And you're in several of those fights. I mean,
win and lose.
Win and lose, but it's got to make you feel good that, you know, you're esteemed that way.
I found it interesting how many times I was in there, but... it goes to show you that people love to see me lose as much as they like to see me win.
Do you find that you don't want to give it up?
I enjoy it. No, I don't want to give it up right now because I still enjoy it. I love it. You know, walking in there, me versus my opponent, I don't have to rely on four other teammates to do anything. I do rely on my corner to tell me what they see, but for the most part, it's me and him.
Have you ever contemplated retiring? And then think to yourself, I can't even train without being the best.
Yes, I do contemplate retiring, but then I go back to this is what I do. This is what I love. I mean, so there's a lot of people that don't want to wake up and go to work every day. I think there's more people that don't than wake up and do enjoy going to work. And right now, I still enjoy working. I still enjoy working out. and that's what I'll continue to do.
What are some of the perks of being an MMA star?
Well, I don't know.
Travel.
Travel. I do like to travel. That would be a perk. I provide pretty well for my family. That's a perk. My wife would say waiting in line to get a seat at a restaurant, maybe somebody noticing me getting bumped up in line would be a perk, you know. So there is times where when you're noticed, it's fun, you know. And I do get noticed a lot, and it's what's interesting to me is who comes up to you, you know. I've had 60-year-old ladies come up to me, give me a kiss on the cheek, and say, "Hey, you're my favorite fighter."
It's amazing.
And that's the funny part to me is who the fans are.
Yep.
You just never know.
You regret your cauliflower ears?
No, these are my trophies. and there'd be a lot of wrestlers say that, but you know, these are one things I've had offers to get them, the cauliflower taken out, you know, and this and that. But no, they're fine. You know, if somebody doesn't like me because of my ears, then that's fine. I didn't want to know them anyway.
You've had a lot of success in this world of MMA and wrestling. What are your disappointments in the world of MMA?
Well, I don't know if I had many disappointments. I'm pretty realistic, you know. Am I disappointed I lost some of my matches? Sure, but that's life. I mean, there's nobody that's going to be undefeated in this sport. There's too many ways to lose. It's just not going to happen. So I really don't have any disappointments. I mean, have I made bad decisions? I have, but for the most part, I'm pretty happy. I couldn't pick one thing out to you and tell you right now, to be honest.
When you're watching MMA on television, do you get frustrated sometimes at some of the things that happen in the octagon?
I do. For the most part, I don't have a complaint with the refs. I used to ref a lot. So I see where I disagree with what the ref has done. Mm-hmm. Maybe it's when somebody's got side control and he's landing effective strikes, standing them up. You know, I just don't agree with that. If he's doing effective striking, let him stay down there. That's what you got to do. What I've really got a problem with is some of the judging, and I would be more vocal about that. Just that we need to have quality judges in there. Without quality judges, I don't think we can go any farther forward. I think we've got to really take care of that problem.
Do you think the 10-9 point system is an issue as well?
I don't have a problem with the system. I just think that, you know, I don't know where some of these judges come up with their criteria. My first criteria has always been, who did the most damage? That's number one.
But for the round or for the whole fight?
For that round.
Okay.
For that round, who did the most damage, you know? And from there it goes, you know, aggressiveness, technique, who had the most control. So there's something. But I'm a big damage guy. That's what I think it's all about, is the amount of damage you put on somebody. So I don't know how they're going to fix it. I'm not saying I know how to fix it. I just wish it was done a little bit better.
How about commentating? Do you ever watch a fight on TV and go, these guys don't even know what they're talking about? I'm not going to mention any names, obviously.
But we won't mention any names, but yeah, I've heard it in all the organizations,
right.
I'll say that. But I'm different. You know, I've been in there.
Yeah.
I know. Somebody would say, well, he needs to do this. Well, actually, he doesn't need to do that. He needs to do something else. You know, I'll give you an example. There's two guys that really come to mind on good commentators, Jens Pulver and Pat Miletich. And I'm not saying that because I used to train with him. Pat's one of the best commentators out there. What makes Pat so good is he doesn't bring everything back to himself.
Yeah.
Some commentators, well, when I used to do this, well, I used to do that. People don't want to hear that. Pat was very good about saying, well, this would be one of the things he needs to do. You know, Pat's just a really good commentator, and I'd love to see Pat do more commentating because he's one of the best. He's, from everybody I talk to, they like to listen to Pat, and Pat is really knowledgeable. And he does a very good job getting that knowledge soaked into somebody else's brain.
Right.
So, I mean, my opinion.
When you see an opponent that you're fighting in a cage make a mistake and you pounce on it, what your favorite mistake that you see in front of you?
Well, no matter what the mistake is, I'm thinking, I gotta make him pay for it. And there's a lot of situations where you want to make people pay. I'm not a kicker. So if I'm fighting a kicker, every time he raises his foot to kick me,
take him down.
I punch him.
Oh, you punch him.
I just want him to know,
or
I take him down. I want him to know every time he lifts a foot, there's a consequence that's going to come. I don't want him to kick me. So I got to make him know right off the bat that every time a foot comes off the ground, something bad's going to happen to him.
Interesting. Okay. Remind me never to kick you. All right, Matt Hughes, thanks so much for coming in.
Thank you.
Really appreciate it.
Anytime.
This has been an exclusive presentation of HDNet.